So welcome to the first Clarence R. Noe Dean's Lecture this year. For 39 years, this interdisciplinary lecture series has showcased the talent and depth of the Eureka College faculty, thanks to the generosity of the Noe family. And we at Eureka College have very fond memories of that. The Dean's Lecture Series was begun by Dean Jerry McCoy in 1980, and I was looking to see if Jerry was here. He's in England, so he's not here, he's in England. The series was created to stimulate discussion among the college faculty and to offer enrichment to students and friends of the college. Throughout the history of the series, special emphasis has been given to lecture topics reaching across academic fields. Dr. Kathy Whitson is a professor of English at Eureka College and has taught here since 1993, 27 years. She did her graduate work at the University of Missouri, where her study focused on Native American literature, especially the works of Louise Erdrich. Kathy is a practicing poet and enjoys teaching in a creative writing sequence at Eureka College. She developed the courses on nature writing and the American Nature Writers at Eureka. She has poetry works published in the Southern Poetry Review, Appalachian Heritage, Appalachian Journal, and she authored the Encyclopedia of Native American Literatures, which is an award-winning work. In 2001, Dr. Whitson won the Helen Cleaver Distinguished Teaching Award. In her spare time, Dr. Whitson enjoys hiking and camping and foraging in the woods of Tennessee. So please welcome tonight's speaker, Dr. Kathy Whitson.
Oh, that's nice. Yes, I gotta say, it is a lovely thing. Dr. Phillip, the confusion about 26 or 27 years is that by the time I'm finished, it will have been 27 school years. And we count that way. You know, I don't wait for the end to happen. Once I start one, I'm assuming I'm in. So, tonight I want to talk to you about Thomas Jefferson. I take as my subject Thomas Jefferson. And I want to tell you a little bit about him, most of which you know. He, of course, was the author of the Declaration of Independence, member of the Continental Congress, legislator from Virginia, author of a very important document called the Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom. He was the guy who made sure we had separation of church and state. That has been an enduring legacy. Governor of Virginia, U.S. Minister to France, Secretary of State, Vice President of the United States, third President of the United States, founder of the University of Virginia, American genius writ large, and owner of 607 humans over the course of his lifetime. So I take Jefferson as my subject, I take poetry as my methodology. I've always found Thomas Jefferson a fascinating human, and I have not always, nor do I now, respect some aspects of his character. I began writing poems about Jefferson several years ago, but took up that project in earnest last spring when I was hanging out with my 261, 361 poetry workshop, and I would give them an exercise to work on, and then I'd sit and write on Jefferson, and I just got so involved in the project, I haven't quit working on it. So the last 6 months I've been reading most of what Jefferson has written, over 18,000 letters, 18,000 letters. These are not tweets, these are real letters. I've read a lot of what's been written about him, but of course what interests me most is the way in which his public persona is a little bit different from his private persona, and his letters reveal a lot of that. He carefully crafted his persona. We'll talk about that as we go on. So there are a lot of contradictions in his life, but the chief one that interests me, and I'm sure it worries all of us, is that here he is, the author of the Declaration of Independence. He's the one who wrote, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal." And if you are of my generation, you could sing this, right? Right? Don't you all know this? You let me down. So, yeah, we know he wrote that. And at the same time, he was a slaveholder. And I suppose, for me, what's the more confounding thing is that most of us have pretty much known that about Jefferson all our lives. We've known that. And yet, we have been desensitized to the tragedy, the human drama that all that implies. Many of us have conveniently erased, or we've unseen, the fundamental flaw in our founders, and have thus ignored the fundamental fracture in the very foundation of our country. Well, this larger-than-life Jefferson that we all learned about, his head, his great, is carved on Mount Rushmore, after all. He's larger than life. He dominated our historical record. But my reading and research gave me a different look that's caused me to think more deeply about these contradictions, these complications in his life. So, the poetry that follows doesn't intend to diminish the legitimate legacy of Thomas Jefferson's many gifts to our nation. Though admittedly, my title, Little Mountain, which is a translation of the name of his home, Monticello, it does suggest a diminishment. So I'm not here to take legitimate praise from him, but I do want to demythologize the narrative of Thomas Jefferson that grew in service to the idea of an America that from the very beginning buried its transgressions and original sins. I want to lay bare parts of his life that have been glossed over in the veneer of an adulating history. But you might ask, to what end do I want to do this? Well, I don't just want to diss the poor guy. He had some good stuff. But I really want to examine those contradictions in his life in order to gain a vantage point to the complexity of the human condition. want to use, as poets do, empathy and imagination to try to understand how we humans probably embody the same kinds of contradictions. So, the poems that I'll read tonight use the poetic technique of the persona. My poets, English majors, will know that in writing a persona poem, the poet speaks in the voice of another person in an effort to more deeply understand that person and to try to render a portrait of that person. The act requires, again, the empathy and imagination that I mentioned earlier. So, even when the voice in the poem uses the first person I, that voice is not my voice, not the poet's voice. It's the voice of the persona, just to be clear, right? Okay. So most of the poems I will read tonight are in the voice of Thomas Jefferson. Like most of us do, Jefferson spent his whole life developing his identity, his character, his own public persona. And though the poems that you will hear tonight may be too small of a sample for you to hear the changes in his voice and persona across the years, the decades, one of the charges I've given myself as a poet is to accurately capture his voice as it changes over the many decades of his life. He lived to be 84, very unusual for his time. So there's a lot of time to look at the growth of this character and how he projects himself through a voice from decade to decade. So a lot of the poems will be in his voice. Other poems will be in the voice of his wife, Martha Wales Skelton Jefferson, his daughter, Martha Patsy, Jefferson Randolph, an unnamed overseer on his plantation, his friend Margaret Baird Smith, and even one poem from his enslaved concubine, Sally Hemings. And before I read that poem later in the evening, I'm going to talk to you briefly about some of the hazards of writing persona poems about people who share a different life condition. We'll talk about that later. So let's begin with the voice of Thomas Jefferson when he learns in 1770 that the Shadwell plantation where he grew up, his childhood home, is burned. Jefferson's father died when Thomas Jefferson was 14. He's 27 now, and he's been, as they say, the man of the house all those years. He's an unmarried lawyer, still living with his mother and siblings at home, although for the last year and a half or so, he's been planning his own home to be called Monticello on a neighboring mountain. He had taken his, like a dutiful son, he had taken his mother out to visit kinfolk, I believe, when an enslaved person ran to him and said, "Oh, young master, your books were all burnt. But we saved your fiddle." So this poem has a kind of ambitious, enthusiastic young Thomas Jefferson commenting on this. He adored his father, and the poem kind of tries to acknowledge that love for his father, who was a surveyor and a map maker. Anyway, Shadwell burns, 1770. Shadwell is in ruins, burnt to the ground in my library with it. My papers, all the engines of my brain turned to ash. Gone are the floorboards that sang with my father's footsteps, that gathered the rustle of mama's skirts. Gone his cherry desk, where lay his map of Virginia, limned in the wilderness with the surveyor's rod, Moses with his staff. But I will build a new altar on the stone cap of Monticello and baptize it afresh with airs from my violin. Well, this next poem, on the banks of the Rivanna River, it takes place 1774, again in Jefferson's voice. On February 21st of that year, an earthquake hit Virginia. You don't think about earthquakes coming to Virginia a lot, but the shock was felt at Monticello. By this time, Jefferson had married, he's living at Monticello, and he writes in his memorandum book, where he kept copious notes on everything, including how many beans it takes to drop into a quart jar to fill the jar. He just kept notes on everything, which is what makes this all the more interesting to me, that he was such a meticulous record keeper. But anyway, in his memorandum book, we learn the earthquake shook the houses so sensible that everybody ran out of doors. Well, in the aftermath Jefferson's sister, Elizabeth, called Bet, is gone. She's disappeared. Jefferson records the earthquake, but he makes no mention of Bet's disappearance until 8 days later, when we read, "My sister Elizabeth was found last Thursday, being February 24th. So in this poem, I'm trying to capture the narrative of Bet's death, but also the emotional reserve of Jefferson that so many of his contemporaries comment on in accounts and letters. So here's "On the Banks of the Rivanna." "On the third day, we found Bet, confounded doubtless by the earthquake that scattered us and unmoored us from all reason. She floated, pale and sodden, in an elbow of the river, covered with leaves and twigs and clumps of mud. Water striders dimpled the water, but did not break through, a lesson in surface tension, one that I must master, though Beth could not." Well, when I first read about Beth and her death, I was taken aback by the scarcity of information that Jefferson had recorded about the death of his sister. I dug a little deeper, and I found buried in the notes of the Founders Online website, by the way, a commercial, this Founders Online website, it's a marvelous thing. It's got all the letters of Jefferson, Washington, Franklin, Hamilton, on and on, all those guys. So I looked in the, and it's a marvelous piece of scholarship. I looked in the footnotes of the Founders Online website, and I found some interesting information. I present that information in the next poem. It's the only poem of the evening where it's, this is my voice speaking. You won't be able to see it. I've asked Emily to bring it forward, which she has done. You won't be able to read it, but I just want you to get the sense of what it looks like. And think about that big blank space there in the middle. This poem is called Footnote Number 13, Superscript Number 1. Footnote. This is from a dictionary footnote. Now, number one, a note, reference or additional piece of information printed at the bottom of a page used to explain or comment on something in the main body of the text on the same page. Number two, something which is additional, subordinate, or less important. So, footnote number 13, superscript number one, wherein we learn, one, Elizabeth Jefferson was very feeble-minded, if not an idiot. Number two, she and her maid were drowned together while attempting to cross the Rivanna in a skiff. Number three, the maid was the slave, Little Sal. Well, that Elizabeth Jefferson was very feeble-minded, if not an idiot. That's interesting to me. Jefferson doesn't record that anywhere, but it's interesting to me. But that another person was drowned in the accident, and that her death and her name are not recorded anywhere in Jefferson's books. Now that, to me, is not only interesting, it's significant by its absence. And that's the kind of thing that's intrigued me about all of this stuff with Jefferson. Well, let's move up a little bit. January 1st, 1772, Thomas Jefferson marries a wealthy 24-year-old widow, widowed at age 20. She married Bathurst Skelton when she was only 18. They were married 2 years before he died in an accident. And in that time, she gave birth to their only child, John. Tragedy struck too soon, though, for little John was dead at age 3. 6 months after John's death, Martha is courted by and marries Thomas Jefferson. So these next two poems are in the voice of Martha Wales Skelton. First, as she grieves upon the death of her son, and secondly, as is when she's on her deathbed herself. So the first poem, on John Skelton, November 7, 1767 to June 10, 1770. Johnny has died while I am still nursing the pain of his father's death. Widow, then, I was called. Unwelcome appellation. But what am I to be called now? What name for a mother who no longer is one? My identity has been twice undone. He was a fair child, as I am fair. He danced when he discovered his shadow, not knowing the kinship of shadow with death, or the sudden chill when a cloud obscures the sun and for a moment cloaks all hope. Bathurst is gone. Johnny is gone. They say my father's wealth makes me attractive. But how could I bear the grief that would follow? Well, she married Thomas Jefferson. They were married only 10 years before she died in the aftermath of childbirth, and though this next poem doesn't mention that, that child died shortly after she did. On her deathbed, she extracted a promise from Jefferson that he would never remarry and put her children under the care of a stepmother, having had difficult experiences with stepmothers herself. In the following poem, In Summation, Martha takes stock of her life and I think perhaps addresses that question she raised in the last poem, how would I bear the grief that would follow? So here she speaks in summation. Four months I've lingered on this fetid bed, my life divided and subtracted, two stepmothers thankfully gone, 11,000 acres from my father, 135 slaves, both burden and boon, two husbands, one dead, 7.5 years pregnant, two sons, both dead, 5 daughters, 2 dead, 3 miscarriages, but 60 keys on my harpsichord, each one luminous and cool to the touch. Well, 1776, an important year in the life of Thomas Jefferson. I think we all know primarily why. It's the year he penned the Declaration of Independence, but it's also the year his mother died. And at her death, Jefferson suffered a debilitating migraine headache. Scholars are not in agreement about Jefferson's relationship with his mother. There's no existing correspondence left between the two. Some suggest that that was a coolness between them. Others suggest that all of those letters were burned when Shadwell burned. But whatever the case, her death caused a migraine reaction stronger than any he had ever had before, since the breakup of his first love in 1764 with Rebecca Burwell. But just as Jefferson didn't spend any time recording or emoting on the death of his sister Beth, he leaves no record, written record, of his emotions after the death of his mother. So in this next poem, I try to acknowledge both his distress over his mother's death, but also his often cited emotional coolness. His friends noted that he was always he was kept in check, always emotionally guarded. So this is a poem about his mother, on Jane Randolph Jefferson, 1720 to 1776. Like a wave that rises to its fullness, crashes, and then is no more. Mother grew ill and died within the hour. We cannot direct the wave to be a wave again, though the water still is all around us. The doctor supposes she died of apoplexy. So, by 1776, Jefferson had inherited enslaved persons from his father and his father-in-law. And in my opening remarks, I suggested that the great enigma surrounding Jefferson is that he was both the father of liberty and an owner of human beings from whom he stole labor, personal agency, and sometimes even life. To his credit, though, for many of the early decades of his life, he truly wrestled with the moral conundrum of slavery. As a young legislator, he proposed anti-slavery measures in the state of Virginia and in the Continental Congress, and he lost the argument in both cases. Though he remained an opponent to the idea of slavery, in the last decades of his life, he, by my interpretation, was resigned to the notion that future generations would have to settle this moral dilemma. He was not going to work on it anymore. So his opposition to the institution of slavery became less and less urgent until by 1820. He could freely acknowledge his own complicity in the institution, as demonstrated by this comment in a letter to John Holmes, and this is a direct quote. "We have the wolf," meaning slavery, "we have the wolf by the ear, and we can neither hold him nor safely let him go. Justice is in one scale, and self-preservation in the other." So, that was by the end of his life, but in 1776, he was still struggling with this idea of slavery. And at the beginning of each year, he would take count of his property, including humans, and record those numbers in his memorandum book. In the following poem called Arithmetic, probably I see you. Oh, and there's Jenny and Jerry are here. Jerry, my boy, we wanted to hail and honor you. First of this lecture series. Anyway, probably this poem is called Arithmetic. I am trying to... I am tempted to digress, but I will hold myself in. So in this poem, I'm trying to capture his sense of dis-ease at being a slave owner, because I think it's important to show that side, too, where he was really wrestling with arithmetic. "The pure reason of mathematics draws me to my study, where the wing of theory startles me so that I might take flight myself. But this accounting I must do each year, to wit, the number of souls in my family in Albemarle County in 1776, 34 free and 83 slave by my ciphering 117, is troubling arithmetic indeed." Well, this next poem is in the voice of Margaret Bayard Smith. Margaret, I'm calling Margaret tonight. Margaret. Is she gonna come up, Emily, Margaret?
It's gonna be a second.
I can't wait a second. I want this picture desperately to come up because look at what she's wearing. I want that stuff. I wish I had, you know, a little Goodwill shopping or something, et cetera, shopping, gotten enough to make an outfit like this. Wait till you see her. Margaret Rapp, if you're in the audience. Well, as I would say in class, fit for this audience tonight, dang it, Bobby. Well, Margaret will come to us sooner or later. Let me go on. This next poem is in Margaret Bayard Smith's voice. She was a writer, a socialite, a popular hostess in Washington, D.C. She was the wife of Samuel Harrison Smith, who was the publisher of a Washington newspaper, the National Intelligence. She was a good friend of Jefferson's. She was a frequent guest at Monticello. And in 1809, on one visit, she was allowed to see Mulberry Row. Mulberry Row was the long line of houses and workshops, a kind of main street of Monticello, of the enslaved community. And most people were not allowed to see that, but she was allowed to see it. It runs parallel to the main house on the mountain. It started at the far end with nicer homes, brick homes for overseers and the white hired help on the mountain, and it moved on down to smaller one-room cabins for enslaved persons and on down to workshops. Jefferson was always trying to make money, so he was always doing things like he built a textile workshop so his enslaved young women could make fabric, spin and weave. He built a nailery in which enslaved young boys from age 10 on would go in and over a hot furnace melt or warm up long rods of iron and hammer them into shape and make nails of all kinds of sizes These boys were in that hot place. There was a joinery where John Hemmings worked. There was a blacksmith shop. But what Jefferson did, I'm looking for Margaret. What Jefferson did was plant a whole row of mulberry trees to hide these enslaved quarters so that when he was up at his house on the top of the mountain, you couldn't see Mulberry Row. And so Margaret Baird Smith got to tour Mulberry Row. And this poem is going to comment on that. But before I go there, I want to say that inside, so Jefferson really tried to keep the machinery of slavery hidden. People came to the mountain to be with him all the time. He was an absolute marvelous host, the best foods, the best wines, the best imported goods. But he designed the public rooms of his house so the flow of traffic wouldn't interfere with his hospitality and the guests would never see the enslaved servants. He always called them servants, and almost all of his writings he called them servants. He never wrote slave. I find that interesting too. So people wouldn't see the enslaved servants coming through, some of whom were his own family members, enslaved family members. He had these clever dumbwaiters and revolving serving doors between the staging room and the dining room to keep the guests from seeing anybody, a slave or a servant. They might sit there all night, a multi-course meal, eat and eat, drink and talk for hours and never see an enslaved person who was responsible for putting that meal together. This is an enslaved house. I don't know what else we saw. Did we see Margaret? Did we? Look at that. Look at that. I think I can do it. So, Margaret toured Mulberry Row. So there, you're kind of looking down the row. To the left of those trees would have been where the enslaved person's quarters were. And in reference to this one on the right, this row of trees kind of almost halfway over, that's the Mulberry Row. So after Margaret Baird Smith toured Mulberry Row, she wrote this to a friend. We passed the outhouses of the slaves and the workmen. They are all much better than I have seen on any other plantation. But to an eye unaccustomed to such sights, they appear poor, and their cabins form a most unpleasant contrast with the palace that rises so near them. So it was Smith's turn of phrase, to an eye unaccustomed, that kind of got me interested, and that was the genesis of this poem. Got me thinking about the proximity of Jefferson's Monticello to the enslaved quarters and the enslaved persons. And I suspect that Jefferson could live so close to these indignities of slavery only if he could keep them concealed, because he worked very hard to keep that from the sight of his guests. So here's a poem I call Mulberry Row. It's from the point of view of Margaret Baird Smith. To an eye unaccustomed, the cabins are an affront, the floor of dirt, the cramped space, the dimness. Yet it is a shelter, and better than most. Still, it gives me pause to wonder about the habitation, not on the mountaintop, but of his mind. Where does it dwell? That this contrast does not wrinkle the facade that he drapes over Monticello, the celebrated seat of his hospitality, where even his guests cannot view the machinery of slavery as they eat from his table. Well, Jefferson spent his entire life in debt for a variety of reasons that I won't rehearse here beyond a few remarks. He inherited debt from his father-in-law when he inherited those 11,000 acres and 135 enslaved persons. He inherited a lot of debt as well. He co-signed on a loan for $20,000 with a friend who defaulted on it. and he was left with the $20,000 debt, which was pretty much eat me up right now, you know, and caused problems for him. And then, he was a profligate spender. He loved to shop. He shopped and shopped and shopped. He shopped. He loved shopping. When he was in France, as U.S. Minister to France, he sent home 84 crates of stuff he bought. He would write in his memorandum book, bought 24 pairs of women's gloves. So anyway, money was always on his mind. It was always on his mind. He kept meticulous records about his expenses, and they always showed that he spent more than he made. So as a farmer, he was looking for ways to increase his profits on the plantations. He had numerous plantations. And in an 1819 letter to his overseer, Joel Yancey, he's reminding Yancey of this thing. He wants Yancey to treat the enslaved women with care and keep them out of the fields so that they can care for their children. And this now is a direct quotation. It's disturbing to me. It might be disturbing to you, but these are the words of Thomas Jefferson. I consider the labor of a breeding woman as no object, and that a child raised every 2 years is of more profit than the crop of the best laboring men. You see why I feel so devoted to this project. I'm trying to figure out how all of this can happen together. Well, I wrote a poem called Cash Crop, where Jefferson is considering what to grow for the greatest financial benefit. He says, you just heard the quotation to his overseer, and now this is the poem imagining Jefferson's voice. By necessity, we must shift to wheat from tobacco. The soil is exhausted. The workers are exhausted by the fickle demands of the crop. The season is long, and the plant requires care that never relaxes. Wheat will place less demand on the soil and on the workers, an advantage that will yield greater productivity elsewhere. For though the besieges of crops with drought and hail and hornworms, nature is still on our side and will yield another crop with greater capital. Well, that's by 1819. No longer a person sitting at his desk worried, troubled by owning people. Well, he groomed his reputation very carefully. He groomed his reputation as a benevolent master. I think in part, of course, to ease his own conscience. And it's true, there is no record anywhere that he ever whipped an enslaved person. But it's also true, and we have plenty of record to show that he would stand by and watch his overseer whip an enslaved person at his command. It's true that he was not a slave trader as his father-in-law was, but nevertheless he accumulated property and wealth on the backs of other humans. It's true that he found the whole business of slavery unsavory, but he could not or would not disentangle himself from it, and he left the distasteful chores of governing other humans to his overseers, most of whom were far less scrupulous than he. In this following poem, it's in the voice of an anonymous overseer. This rough-looking guy is named Edmund Bacon, and Edmund Bacon was his overseer at Monticello for over 20 years and was one of his best guys. It looks belie behavior I can see that I would not want to cross Edmund Bacon. This is an aside, but earlier I told you that Jefferson was in debt a lot. Sometimes he would get so far in debt that he would need to borrow money from his overseer. And his overseer would say, well, you know, I'll trade you that debt for. And his overseer, a accumulated enslaved persons because of Jefferson's death. Anyway, Jefferson had over 60 overseers in the course of his plantation management, and in this poem I give the voice to an overseer. An overseer comments on Mr. Jefferson. He is a man of a bifurcated mind, though I astonish myself to make that claim, for what am I to know of bifurcation? The word, its meaning, even its value as a descriptor? Still, it's not for nothing that I have followed in his wake and heard his conversations with his friends and his visitors over all these years. And so I dare make the claim that he does not know himself or his desires. My desires are simple enough and easily satisfied, but his are lofty. Philosophy and architecture and words in Latin to describe the commonest we, things of that ilk that do not catch on the nub of my soul. Lately, though, he has succumbed to a more basic desire, one that will undo him in the end. It riddles his reason and blinds him to the split path he must contemplate. His directions to me are clear. Rein them in, he beseeches. Do them no harm, he cautions. As if both things are possible. Well, the overseer's observations lead us to the inevitable story of our fascination with Thomas Jefferson after 200 years of rumor, speculation, and accusation about Thomas Jefferson and his relationship with his enslaved housemaid, Sally Hemings. A 1998 DNA study confirmed the statistical certainty that Jefferson did father six children with his enslaved maid, Sally Hemings. Their relationship, and I'm hesitant to call it a relationship, but we'll talk later about what do you call this, spanned 38 years. It started in Paris in 1787 when Sally was called to Paris as the guardian of Jefferson's youngest daughter, Mary, who was called Polly. Jefferson and his daughter Patsy were in Paris after his wife died. Polly and Lucy, little Lucy, were left at home with family. Lucy dies. And Jefferson's so distraught at the death of little Lucy, he says, I've got to have Polly with me now. And he arranges for someone to escort Polly from Virginia to Paris. And Sally was tapped into this service. She was 14 years old when she made the trip across the Atlantic. She stayed 2.5 years in Paris with Jefferson. Her brother also, her brother James, was in Paris. He had been taken by Thomas Jefferson to learn French cooking so that he could return to Virginia and make great meals. But when she returned to Virginia after 2.5 years, so she's now 16.5, she's pregnant with Jefferson's child. And this just gets weirder by the moment because Sally Hemings was the half-sister of Thomas Jefferson's wife, Martha Wales Skelton Jefferson. It's, what are we to make of this? Well, it's complicated. An enslaved woman could not reject the sexual advances of a man, especially her owner. In fact, in that time, a woman, a married woman, could not legally refuse her husband's sexual overtures. But in Paris, where Jefferson was the U.S. minister to France, where his two daughters were living in a convent, getting educated in a safe, very safe environment, because he wanted to protect them, where it was there then that Thomas Jefferson begins a sexual relationship with a 15-year-old girl that he owned. Sally's brother was training to be a French chef. And Sally and James both became aware through their time there that in France, they could not be slaves. They couldn't be enslaved. French law would have freed them had they gone to a court and appealed for their slavery. Neither of them did that, and that's a bit of an enigma. I suspect neither did because they would have been stranded then in France when Jefferson left. No family, no way to go back home, separated from everybody, but neither claimed their freedom. Madison Hemings, James Madison Hemings, the son of Sally Hemings and Thomas Jefferson, wrote about this. And he says that Sally refused to return to Virginia, that they had an argument. She spoke up and she refused to return to Virginia with Jefferson unless he promised that he would free any and all children that would come from this liaison by the time they reached the age 21. Well, he did. There were 6 children born to this union, 4 children lived into adulthood, and at age 21, they were, 2 of them were allowed to walk off the plantation. Walk off. And weren't chased. And 2, when they turned 21, were manumitted. So, in that sense, Jefferson was true to his word. This next poem is in the voice of Sally Hemings, and I want to acknowledge this trepidatious water I enter now here as an artist when I try to imagine the life of a cultural other, one whose experience I haven't lived through. I've not been enslaved. I have not been put into that kind of bind in any way. But as a poet, I want to try to use what I talked about at the front, empathy and imagination, to try to render the voice and experience of the other. The outcome will be imperfect, and there will be those who might say that I have no right to speak in the voice of this enslaved woman, but I'm going to choose to err tonight on the side of our common humanity, and to put before us the quandary that bedeviled this living, breathing human being who struggled against the very real powers of patriarchy and, quite frankly, white supremacy. So before I do that, I want to give you a brief note about English and then early American law. Until 1662, if a child was born, it followed the legal status of its father. So if the father was free, the child was free. Well, with all of the relationships, sexual relationships between white owners and enslaved African women, you can see why this became problematic for the slave owners. If the child born to that union followed the condition of the father, that child would be free. So in 1662, a law was passed that said that the child will follow the condition of the mother. The Latin phrase is partus sequitur ventrum. The offspring follows the condition of the mother. So this is partus sequitur ventrum in the voice of Sally Hemings. Let us gloss over the reasons for the situation I find myself in. Mama is across the Atlantic, but I think I've seen enough to imagine what is at hand without her telling me. Still, I wish she were here, or I were with her. There is little advantage a woman. Dare I call myself a woman yet? She's 16. There's little advantage a woman has when carrying a child, when the months are her master, when the motion set in place must meet its end. I find myself on slope, I am sure, though James and the master will not discern my condition. My body holds its secret yet, and I'm thankful for the time to decide my course. How shall I press my advantage, if advantage I have? I know well the phrase partus sequitur ventrum, for it's on the lips of every accountant in Virginia. What I carry is eyes and nose, fingers and toes, God willing, but also shillings and pounds, a product to gild the master's purse. Shall I prevail in this discourse with Jefferson? Jefferson, whose pen swept a rabble into a nation? Shall I cast my die and my child against his lust, his vanity, his power? She did. She did, and she extracted a promise from Jefferson that her children would go free. So that begins the situation between Jefferson and slave Sally Hemings. Sally, of course, left no written record that could reveal her feelings about this. One thing we do know for certain is that consent would be problematic given the extraordinary power Jefferson had over her. He was a white man, 30 years her senior. He was classically educated. He was the best writer of his generation, one of the best thinkers. He was a revered patriot. He was the founder of the nation. He was a man who skillfully crafted and guarded his public persona with care. He was a man who was the owner of her body and the offspring of her body. I count it a real act of bravery that she sparred with him. Well, as early as 1802, these allegations that Jefferson was involved with his enslaved servant were abroad, they were out, they were swirling everywhere, and by 1802, they were in the newspaper. The Richmond Recorder printed an article about this relationship. Jefferson never said anything about it, but his daughter, Patsy, Martha Jefferson Randolph Patsy, his white daughter, very carefully curated his legacy. So this next poem is in her voice, and it's upon the death of her sister Polly, or upon the occasion of her sister Polly's death. Polly is her last surviving white sibling. So Martha Jefferson Randolph in 1804 says, "Polly is dead. The baby survives. Too much like Mama, she couldn't bear the travails of childbirth. I am Papa made over, red-haired and hale, my constitution so sturdy that I take Polly's babe to my breast along with my own. Of his children, I alone survive." There are others, it is said. "And certainly I must block my eyes and stuff the workings of my brain into a box too small to hold it, to keep faith with that lie. But alone now, his legacy is mine to guard. Polly had Mama's beauty. I had his long shank and straight back, so I will stand against all blows, direct or glancing. There is no mistress at Monticello save I alone." And so tonight I'm going to leave you with one last poem entitled "Last Instructions to Patsy." In which I'm trying to imagine what Thomas Jefferson said to her as his own death was imminent. She and her children, she had 12 children, they waged an active public campaign against the rumors of the Jefferson-Hemings connection. And I believe she knew the truth of the matter. For Jefferson requested that she do something upon his death, and he did it. Let's listen to that in this poem, "Last Instructions to Patsy." "Untangle the skein, and you will do harm to all I love. There is no good in acknowledging this truth. The best course now, still, is silence. John Hemings has made my coffin. Ask Wormley Hughes to dig my grave, clean-sided and redolent of the mountains, rained fresh into dirt. Bury my shortcomings with my bones, and give Sally her time." This practice of giving time was an unofficial emancipation. And Patsy did. Sally was unofficially emancipated and was allowed to leave Monticello. She went down to Charlottesville, Virginia, and lived with her two sons, Eston and Madison, who had been granted their freedom at age 21. She went down and lived with them until she died. And then when she died, they hightailed down there, went up to Ohio, to free state. So to narrate the whole of this Thomas Jefferson life would take far more time than I'm allotted here. I'm out of time. I have about 45 more poems on Jefferson. Some of them are finished and some are still in process, but I've got more going. I hope, though, tonight that I've left you with enough information about Jefferson, that I've challenged you to think critically about the mythology that hovers over our national story of origin. I hope that I've helped you think about the way that art generally, and poetry specifically tonight, can call us into dialogue about the questions that are central to the health of our democracy, to our community, and to our enlightened understanding of the complexities of the human condition, his and ours as well. So, thank you very much. That's it for Thomas Jefferson tonight. That's a good question. You know, what I did was, for months and months, I just wrote and I kept a notebook. And at the top of every page, every time I had something that would pique my interest, say like the Margaret Barron Smith quotation, to the eye unaccustomed, I would just write that at the top of the page. And I'd keep reading and I'd see something else. One of the first things I wrote down was, when Thomas Jefferson was president of the United States, a church, I think maybe in Maryland, I'd have to check, sent him this enormous cheese, like 3,000-pound cheese or something. And it stayed in the White House for 2.5 years, and it just was slowly rotting. And I thought, what a metaphor for this whole thing, this huge rotting cheese in the White House. I hadn't planned that. But so at the top of the page, I wrote, enormous rotting cheese. And I'm still working on that poem, but I would just do that. And so I've got notebooks with pages, and then I just leave that page blank, and as I continue to read, I write down details, and then I start thinking, how can this come together as a poem? And it's obvious that you can't see it because I was reading it, but I tried very much to work in some fixed forms. I wrote sonnets, I have a pantoum, a villanelle. I didn't read villanelle or pantoum tonight, but I'm trying to work within a fixed form so as to get into the headspace of the Enlightenment and the Age of Reason and think about things like that. So I tried to do that, but I don't want to sound as if this is a cliche through multiple repetitions, but I really did try to engage a sense of empathy and imagination. I'm trying to say, okay, what would he say? And a lot of times I will just put a direct quote straight into the poem, straight from his voice, but I try to italicize that to show his voice, my voice. But yeah, it takes a mental, and as you suggested, a spiritual toll to try to think about this, to try to imagine being a person among many of his peers. This is the whole national flavor, right? It's okay. It's okay to own other humans. It's hard to go into that space, but to me, it seemed important work to try to do. Does that help you to address that? Any other questions? I know you're waiting for the poem on the rotting cheese. Yes.
I'm curious, as you think about, it sounds like you're kind of envisioning this as eventually being sort of a book project, how you would reflect on all the research that you did to kind of precipitate these poems. It would be an introduction. If you imagine like an ebook with hyperlinks to some of the inspiring documents that sort of lead to the poem, or how you would sort of...
I'm not a digital native. I can do an ebook link.
The amount of research that kind of went into to create these books.
Yeah, so that's a real question. I hadn't thought about an introduction or anything, but what I did have to do, a lot of these poems will not stand on their own without some contextualizing information. They just won't. So I made frequent use of the epigraph, you know, where I might take, like in the Joel Yancey letter, where he talks about keep the women out of the field so that they can produce a good crop. He says, every 2 years, be about what I want, a crop of humans coming forth. I picked that up and put that at the front of the poem as an epigraph to try to establish some context. We'll see if that is enough, right? I can't, as I say to my students all the time, you can't run alongside your poem with your little suitcase explaining to everyone what that meant. You know, the poem has to do it on its own. So that is something I'm trying to think about. I'm trying to use those italicized portions to indicate direct quotations, to try to help that. I'm trying to use epigraphs. Yeah, maybe a contextualizing introduction might be a good thing if it becomes a public point before. Yeah, it's always in my head. Maybe one more. I know the hour is late, but any other? Yes. Is that Emily?
Yes, it is.
Hello, Dan.
Hi. I'm curious about the organization, the order of the poems in your book. Are you ordering them chronologically or perhaps by persona? Or could you say a little bit more about
It's not a book yet. Not a book till somebody says it's a book. But I do, in my fondest dreams, hope that it will become a book, and I'm sending stuff out. You know, I want to get some publications here and there, get enough momentum to shop a book. But I'm thinking chronologically. I'm thinking chronologically because I really am trying to show how he wrestled with this issue, or failed to wrestle with it for a long, long time. I'm also trying to capture, and tonight a lot of the poems were showing what I see as the confounding ironies of his life, and I hope that those ironies were making themselves manifest to you. But I'm also trying to capture, you know, just his youthful exuberance. He was a young man in love. He spent too much money on horses, and, you know, he had a life. He was a fascinating human. I want to capture all that too, because that's fair, right? How unfair to just write about the metaphoric rotting cheese, right? I don't want to go there. I want to try to encapsulate the fullness of his life and still try to figure out how this was okay, you know? So, if you have some other questions, I think there are probably toothsome treats outside, and we can hang around out there. But let me thank you again for coming. I'm so thrilled.